You're listening to the Final Draft Insider View, a podcast where we talk to screenwriters about breaking every single rule of screenwriting in one single screenplay. Well, all right, normally we don't talk about that all in one podcast, but today we're going to cover that a lot. Today's guest is Eric Heisserer. His credits include The Thing, A Nightmare on Elm Street, Lights Out, Hours, and we're going to be talking about the movie Arrival, out in theaters now. Eric, thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks for having me on.
So let's talk a little bit about your how you got into writing and what inspired you to take on this career.
Well, I think I got planted with this idea when I was very young. My mom chose to expand my brain by reading to me not like Dr. Seuss or other material like that. She picked up Heinlein and Bradbury and Asimov and read amazing sci-fi to me. And that really got me hooked to bigger worlds and bigger questions about life and the universe. I managed to parlay that into sort of an autodidactic need to learn stuff on my own. I taught myself a bunch of Adobe software right out of high school and landed, much to my surprise, my first real job as layout designer for space industries and NASA. So that I was surrounded by astrophysicists and literal rocket scientists.
Wow.
and it was great just because they did all the heavy lifting and all the science and the math, and it was my job to make it look pretty, you know, and dress it up. But really where I realized I have to tell stories came from whenever we would successfully deliver a proposal and we got funding for some other project, because then there would be a party at the company. And I wasn't 21 yet, so there was a lot of booze and then ginger ale for me. And after 2 hours, hanging around drunk astrophysicists is probably the funnest time I've had in my young life. Because they just start to go off on any and all kind of sci-fi idea and how they would practically make that work. You know, I remember one of them with a lazy eye on too much red wine started to break down how you don't send a nuke to destroy an asteroid. You just paint it white and the sun does the rest.
Yeah, that's fun. That's a fun experience.
Yeah.
So you can learn some interesting stories that way.
Yeah, and it stuck with me. And so I started first to take a swing at prose. I wrote short stories. I tried my hand at a novel. And none of those adequately scratched the itch. They got close, but it really wasn't the sweet spot for me. And it wasn't until I got a rejection from a publisher who said that it didn't work in its current form, but it might make an interesting movie. I took that as a dare, and I went out and I bought Final Draft that day.
Wow.
And got me, this was in the mid-90s when the internet was still new and bright and shiny, and there was no place to get PDFs of screenplays online. There were no repositories like that. So I went to Barnes & Noble, and I bought a William Goldman screenplay. I bought Butch Cassidy, right? Mm. You know, that's in a bound form there, and took it home and tried to figure out that format and dove in. And my first script was, oh, it was so terrible. It was bad. But it gave me the fever. I realized this is really what I love doing most of all. And I began to plot and scheme to find a way to make it a career.
Wow. So what was that first story? What was that first story? Do you remember it at all?
The screenplay?
Yeah.
Yes. It was about a lonely man whose all of his friends that he had growing up had married off and found other people, and they were doing couples things, and he wound up being the odd man out. And so he discovered an ad, a classified ad, where you send off and you get in the mail a compass that points you to your soulmate. And he gets one and he puts together and he goes off on it. It's a road trip movie. And it's about him trying to follow this thing to find a soulmate and discovering some hard truths along the way.
Okay. That's sad. Hey, that sounds fun. Okay. So then what happens after that screenplay? What, where does it wind up starting to occur to you that this career is going to take off, that this is going to work?
It wasn't until my fourth or fifth feature script that I managed to get hip-pocketed by a manager who I was actually based out of New York. And they got it in the hands of some people in Los Angeles. And that ultimately led to an option by Artisan Entertainment. That was my first real money as a screenwriter in the business. And made me think maybe I could do it. But I was still living in Houston at the time. And I was worried that I would show up in town with just one option or script sale under my belt and all my dreams would come crashing down within a few months. So, so I, you know, I took some time off and I wrote a few other scripts and tried to get one more, a lightning strike. And that happened in, I guess that was 2001 where I got another sale. It was a little independent feature.
Wow.
And I thought, okay, all right, this is going to work. And, I got two projects that are moving forward. So that's when I packed everything up and I moved out to LA, and within 60 days, both of those projects just fell apart. And I was suddenly, it happened regardless, you know?
Right. So pack your bags and watch everything crash around you.
Yep.
So what did you do next? Everything was in shambles and you suddenly have no future instead of the future you'd hoped for.
Right. I found myself being more and more hermit-like. I would just stay in, cause I didn't know anybody here in LA at the time. I would just try to write my way out of it, and realize that I desperately needed some semblance of a life, especially a social life, if I was going to survive. And so I took a friend up on an invite to a party, which was out somewhere in the valley. And on my way there, I got a little bit lost and drove past a house that looked exactly like a house that I would drive by on my commute in Houston. And that little idea stuck with me for a while. But I didn't know what to do with it until I was up in a bout of insomnia and saw a special on a Nature Channel about Venus flytraps. And I had, you know, the narrator was talking about how I was saying, the Venus flytrap has 100 identical mouths and they disguise themselves as shelter for insects. And that stuck in my mind and combined with that other idea, and I thought, oh my goodness, what if we're the insects? And what if these really aren't houses? These are just mouths. It was sort of a Lovecraftian horror story that began to unfold. And I had that idea. I wrote a treatment for that, and I called my manager and I said, I think I've got an original horror idea. I've never done horror before, but this is definitely one. And he said, that's great, kid, but they're not buying original material anymore. And by the way, I'm leaving the business.
More good news.
More good news, right. So I again took that as a dare, the way my stubborn brain often does. And with really no money, I went ahead and purchased a website and began crafting my own source material, like a little epistolary story told via shared emails online. And I was going to point producers to this and say, aha, here's the source material, here's the story, and now here's the movie version. But I discovered that, I discovered the hard way how like Google search index works. And while I was in the midst of putting that up, I was discovered and I got a flood of visits and of hits. And it sort of blew up on me. I didn't realize what going viral meant, and wow. I wasn't trying for that. It happened on accident. I don't think I could have done nearly as well had I tried to do that on purpose.
Wow.
But I had a flood of people. Like 20% knew it was fiction. They saw the copyright notice at the bottom of all the pages, and they're like, you know, if half of those were like, ooh, scary story, the other half was like, you suck and your writing sucks, you know, like the normal internet type of response.
Nice.
But it's the majority that I found most fascinating were 8 out of 10 emails were taking it as gospel truth. I had people that say, hey, I went to school with Matt, or I'm good friends with Jen, and let me help out. And you know, give me an address of one of these houses and I'll go look at it.
Wow. That's really great. So so it took a life of its own, for sure.
It did. And that ended up eventually turning into a spec screenplay that I was most proud of, because it also had a URL on the cover page that they could go to and see. And that sold to Warner Brothers. That was the real breaking in script that I'd been needing, and it happened at the time when I had to pay for my rent with my credit card that was already kind of at max balance.
So the third sale was the point where stuff started to be okay.
Yes.
Wow. What was that script called? In case we want to go back and look.
That was called The Dionea House, which is Latin for Venus flytrap. Dionea was called. So.
That's great. So that sells. And then at that point, what do you start getting hired to on assignments?
I do. And on horror assignments, I get hired for those. A lot of them never see the light of day. Mm-hmm. But then Elm Street was on rocket boots. They needed to get that thing moving very quickly. And I was brought on to do a very fast draft for them.
Was that at a point in your career where you could kind of choose your projects, or were you just, they offered something and you said yes?
I desperately needed to continue to pay rent. I was a beggar. I was not a chooser.
Gotcha. Okay. So just tracking the trajectory here. I'll jump forward a little bit to Arrival, because I know you've worked on this since it was a short story by Ted Chiang called Story of Your Life.
Mm-hmm.
At what point did you find that with all of this going on?
I found my way to Ted Chiang by another story called Understand. I found that as like an online sci-fi magazine and devoured it. And I thought, I wonder if this guy's done anything else, because it was really engaging. Discovered he had a whole collection of stories, and I bought that on Amazon. I got it 2 days later, and I remember getting it like in the afternoon thinking, I'll just take a look at the first story and see if it like rocks my world the way Understand did. And then you cut to 5 hours later, I'm halfway through the book, and I get to Story of Your Life, and I'm just completely emotionally wrecked. I'm a mess. I'm weeping. I feel better about the world and also worse at the same time, which is a real hat trick, you know?
Yeah. People.
And after I collected myself and found as many friends to hug, I said to myself, I've got to share this with the wider audience. I've got to make this a movie somehow. And so it was entirely just the feeling that I had to it that that I was excited about sharing. I really wasn't thinking too much about, can this be adapted into a film or not? I was too caught up in the sort of my passion for...
It had to be adapted.
Yeah.
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 So what were your first steps there? I mean, you knew, you made this decision. Did you contact the author at that point?
I didn't try yet. I wanted to make sure that I had a production company that was as passionate about it as I was, so that we could, you know, work as a collective team. Mm-hmm. And when you do the bottled water tour, of course, you always get the question from producers, hey, is there any material out there you want us to grab for you?
Wow.
And thus began my campaign. Every time I had a meeting and got the bottle of water and a producer asked me that question, I would say, yes, absolutely. Story of Your Life, Ted Chiang. And I now, you know, present me now realized what past me was doing wrong with all those meetings, but I didn't realize at the time, because I would, you know, when I start pitching what it is, I would be like, well, it's a non-franchise sci-fi story with a female lead, and it deals with linguistic relativity, and why are you taking my water away? You know,
right.
I kind of get kicked out the door. So it wasn't really until I had shown that I could do something outside of the horror genre that I'd sort of been trapped in for a while when I wrote and directed Hours. I got another meeting, and this is with Dan Levine and Dan Cohen over at 21 Laps, and they said that they were very interested in my non-horror work, and is there anything else out there that I was interested in? And I almost didn't tell them, because I'd gotten so many rejections at this point in time.
Wow.
In the story of life. But on my way, literally out the door, you know, I can't believe it's as tropey as this, but it is. That like I'm like, well, yes, Ted Chiang, Story of Your Life, it's the one movie I'd want to make, you know, if I could only make one more. And they read it. They actually read it and engaged with it, and they got it the way I did. Hmm. And all of us got on the phone and said, let's try and make this work. So it was the three of us then that reached out to the author.
Wow. Okay. Wow. And then we're now talking at the end of 2016 when the movie's just come out. What time period was this when you guys finally, when they had read it and you guys reached out to the author?
2011.
So some time after that still elapsed, even after everybody was excited about it.
Sure. I mean, by everybody, it's three people at this point.
Right.
Because what we did, we got a shopping agreement from Ted that allowed us in a slightly limited window to prepare a pitch and then go out and pitch it and see if we could set it up at a studio. And I did that, and I made cards for the pitch characters. And the way I pitch, I do cards as more of a visual metaphor, visual representation. It looks more like a mood board, because I realize if I put text on note cards, the people I'm pitching to start reading instead of listening. So I do my best just to put little pretty pictures, and I cast the movie. And the longstanding joke of maybe I know some heptapod of my own is that I cast Amy Adams back in 2011 before I realized.
I guess you do, yeah. You saw the future.
And I organized the pitch so that it was at the end of it. I made a circle.
Ah, that's nice.
But for all that work, every studio said no. Every studio passed. And the most common note we got was, "We think this is execution dependent," which is a kind of generic pass. That sometimes it means you need a filmmaker in order to make this happen, and sometimes it means we don't think you have enough talent to write this.
Mm, ouch.
Right. But, I took my lumps, and I realized after all of that, I still had so much love for the story, I couldn't let it go. I called up the Dans and said, "I'm going to write this on spec." And all my reps said, "That is ridiculously bad." Every buyer in town just said no to this. There's literally no place you can take the script when it's out. And I said, I can't stop it. I have to do this. And so I then had to pitch the idea to Ted over the phone in order to get an extension on those rights. Wow. And that was really, I've done 100 pitches to a bunch of execs, several of whom were terrible people, at least, in terms of how to behave in a pitch. And I was no more nervous in my career than I was trying to pitch Ted's story back at him.
Yeah.
Thankfully, he gave us the window, and I started writing that night. And then a year later, toward the end of 2012, I had a script I was pretty proud of, and we went out with that. And once again, every major studio passed. But this time, the independent financiers caught it and loved it and were very excited and very passionate about it. And so we had what an agent friend of mine calls the featherweight bidding war among these little tiny houses out there. People that are like, "We love it. I'll give you $20. I'll give you $22. So it was that kind of thing. And we found then two buyers that teamed up together to collaborate on this one. That's Film Nation and Lava Bear, Aaron Ryder, David Lendy. They were very passionate, and they both joined up, and we had ourselves a chance to make the movie. And it was just a matter of finding a director and star.
Not to say that that's the easy part, but I mean, it sounds like that was a long journey already. How long did it take you to write this script on spec? You pitched it 100 times, so you obviously knew the story very well in your own mind.
Right.
But how long, how much time did you spend writing that?
I spent most of the year that I had the rights, most of the clock I ran that down trying to find the sweet spot. What I discovered in execution that wasn't quite as transparent to me during the story pitch is the alchemy there, the balance between the emotional storyline and the scientific or intellectual one. There was a balance there, and you had to get it just right.
One of the things that has, I read the script years ago, one of the things that has informed my own writing from reading that script is just how those things can interplay, the actual character story and the emotional needs versus solving the problem of the minute can overlap in a really fun and brilliant way. And that was one thing that came through even in the early versions of the script.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. I'll confess, I had a copy of this at one point after I think it had made the blacklist. Am I right?
Yes.
Yeah. I imagine that had to help a bit.
It did. It really did. By and large, because I think, at least at the time, Denis Villeneuve was always looking at blacklist scripts as potential next projects. I think prisoners got on his radar in a similar fashion. Mm-hmm.
Was, you know, he wound up getting attached as director. Did things change after that? Was it different directions? Was there new partners involved after that? What happened after that?
By and large, it was just a road to getting the film made. He had already committed to Sicario, so we had to wait. And waiting is terrible because, you know, 9 times out of 10, your director will end up just walking away in favor of some new shiny thing that they like
right.
when they're done with the project. So we were really biting our nails and hoping that he'd come back to us after that. And thankfully he did. But the crux of the story really didn't change. The script did undergo some cosmetic changes. Mm-hmm. And there's one main narrative change that happened between Denis signing on and the final film, and that was the gift that the heptapods give humanity.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Can you talk about that? Why was that? Why did you guys decide to go a different direction with that?
Sure. It really was affected by Interstellar.
Ah. Wow.
In that there was enough to that story and similarity of Matthew McConaughey and the Tesseract basically trying to give some key technology information to his daughter about building interstellar spaceships that we thought, I don't know if we can have our aliens, you know, also communicating some interstellar spaceships design stuff to our characters. And when we explored it a bit further, I discovered that Denis was uncomfortable with the spaceship idea for a while, simply because he did not want the message of the movie to be, hey, humanity, you've done a really good job of messing up your own planet. Here's a design to a ship so you can go mess up a whole bunch of others.
Well thought out, actually. That's a great point.
Right.
Yeah. All right. So there's a couple myths that I think come up, and I sent this script around to some friends a couple years ago just to show some people who are very focused on screenwriting rules. So I think this breaks so many rules, and it does it so well that it kind of dispels those myths. I mean, the first one that comes to mind is you can't put pictures in your screenplay. Everyone knows that.
Right.
And can you talk about why you decided to put some of the alien language in there, some of those images, and how that evolved for you?
It evolved out of frustration, like a lot of things do with me. and it was because I have a pet peeve on screenwriting, which is never to be novelistic. Large chunks of text, large paragraphs and blocks of information turn me off. That's not really what I want a screenplay to look like. And it doesn't work for me too well as a reader unless there's a very particular reason for it, in which case there's an exception out there somewhere that always proves the rule. And as I got to my description of the heptapod's written language, I found myself being more and more expository and wordy and almost dry and scientific. I couldn't find a really smart metaphor for the written version, and it was really frustrating me because it would clog up a page where I didn't want a reader to slow down. I wanted them to be, you know, instantly picturing something and then moving on. And I was complaining about this to my wife, like we do to spouses. And she said, I can't see what you're talking about. Can you just draw for me what you're talking about and show me? And so I did a circular kind of logogram there at dinner, and her response was, well, just put that in there. And nice. I said, you really can't put can you put graphics in it? and of course it turns out you can't, you have to do it by kind of hacking the system a little bit.
Yeah.
And I inserted those in via PDFs, but it was a great relief to me because I didn't spend much time on the description. I just put that in, and then I limited myself to 5, that I wouldn't do more than that. And I wouldn't really use it in many other ways other than having it pertain to the logograms themselves.
Right.
The only other one that is not that is when Louise Banks signs her signature and she does it in a circle. Mm-hmm. I put that in there as well, just because I thought, well, it's going to look cool. But that was the one darling I gave myself outside of that rule. And the way it helped me was that I had to manually do that every time I made a new draft, and I did a lot of those. So had I done more graphics in the script, I would have been killing myself.
Right. I mean, just more prone to putting the wrong gram in the wrong page. And
Yeah.
Well, it was really fantastic. I mean, it was a really concise way to show what would have taken paragraphs to describe.
Yeah.
I think wasted paragraphs.
Yeah.
So there's another, I mean, another one of those myths. I think I would have been in that same camp if you had pitched this to me as your friend in 2011. I would have said, no, Eric, you can't make a script about a linguist as a main character. That's it's just not going to work. Clearly, yeah. It does. So what was the challenge in bringing that to life? What was the challenge of bringing her struggle to something that's cinematic?
Well, the nature of her structural, the nature of her struggle is very similar to the struggle that a lot of us have right now in this extremely connected world, possibly overly connected world, where we're discovering we're really not that good at talking to each other, and we have the best tools for talking to each other that we've had in our history. Therefore, it becomes a case of how is someone who is an expert in language navigate everybody else's linguistic shortcomings and her own in order to bridge all of these gaps and get everybody on the same page. All of her examples about how you can be misinterpreted, at the kangaroo story, for instance, and plenty of other little anecdotes that were scattered throughout the script are really a sign of a request for help of, like, you know, stop and listen first. Ask for clarification before you move on. Don't come in guns first, and don't make assumptions about anybody else.
That sounds like a very NASA approach to problem solving, if ever there was one.
Yeah, I think that was the younger me, you know, with my experiences around them, reminding myself how they work.
That's great. So let's talk a little bit more about rewriting. Were you on this for shooting, and were you on set? Were you contributing at that point, or had you moved on to other things?
I was on set. I was contributing. Denis worked very closely with his writers. In fact, when he finally signed on, and it was after a long courtship, he gave me a call directly and says, "All right, Eric, now we are married." And he really meant it. Like, you know, any type of writing request, it came through me. And he just delegated a lot of that. Like, all the dialogue that the anchors, random anchors, say in various news reports, if there's any TV screen that's playing, odds are I had to write dialogue for it.
Wow. Okay.
You know, stuff that might be seen on set, I'd get a call. What should this be in the background on this glass screen here? Or, you know, what writing should be in other locations around the set. By the time I got there, they had been shooting for about 3 or 4 weeks, and it was a well-oiled machine. It was a very calm and low-key kind of shoot, I think, in part because everybody was making the same movie. Yeah. And that sounds like a given, but it is rare in my experience.
Right. I mean, I think that's one of those classic tests that if you can get everybody to envision the same movie with the script, you're doing a good job. That's so rarely happens.
Yeah.
What were some of the decisions you were making on set? Like, you remember you said something on the glass back here. What kinds of things were you putting in there? And did they really matter to you, or did you just have to make an arbitrary rubber stamp?
Some of them mattered in terms of what logograms could be analyzed and what could they mean. There was a logogram that was said to mean all of humanity. And there was an aspect of it that I needed to make sure carried over for narrative reasons that wound up getting cut, of course. So we really didn't get to explore that as much in the final film. But it needed to be an ambigram, so you could read it frontwards or backwards, and it'd be the same thing.
Mm-hmm. There was one specific logogram I remember in the script that I don't think made it into the movie. It was a line that showed, you know, I think the 8% of time humanity had left.
Yes.
And then, you know, the big reveal is that we flipped that around for a different interpretation. That was when my wife actually quoted back to me after she read the script, and I thought, that wasn't just me that really liked that. Where did that, I mean, that obviously didn't make it to past the cutting room floor. What happened with that? Was there a choice to leave it out in the script, or was that more later?
It was all shot. That was once we got into editorial that Denis realized that there was a little too much in the middle of the script that didn't feel like it was the proper escalation. And it wound up feeling like we were kind of just spinning our wheels a little bit. Mm-hmm. And so he looked at that segment and tried to see if we remove the timeline riddle, which was kind of a test that that deposit had given us.
I see.
And just get to the sort of the final conflict a little sooner. What does that do? He was also looking for cuts like that because I think the first rough cut was around 2.5 hours.
Wow! So you really just had to save some space.
Yeah.
What was your favorite part of working on this whole thing? I mean, what's the thing you take away as a writer or as a person?
I was really spiritually bolstered by the number of people who are still in this business because they truly love movies and they want to make good film and they want to make good art. I'd had some bad experiences with projects that actually never made it to screen.
Hmm.
And people that don't seem to like what it is they do in this business. And and that really started to cast a shadow over my heart. Cause I'm like, well, how do you succeed here then if you're surrounded by a lot of people that just don't like it. In fact, there's somebody who was, I'm not going to mention who, but there's somebody on the creative side during the production of Elm Street who just confessed in front of the whole cast and crew, you know, I really don't like Freddy Krueger.
That hurts.
And I thought how depressing it is that you're now part of this, making this work and make it good. And if you don't like what you're doing, it's so hard to get into the business. And then it's so hard to stay in the business that if you don't love this, then it feels like torture. I don't know how that works. So the greatest gift that I got from this was to be around so many people who love film and who love doing this and were excited about making this story in particular. That really reinvigorated me.
That's great. So what new amazing pieces of art do you have coming down the pipeline next?
I don't know what's going to happen next, really. There are a handful of projects that are in various stages. My favorite probably would be another adaptation, actually. It's a Josh Malerman novel that I adapted called Bird Box, and that is currently at Universal. And we have Eddie Muschietti on board to direct. But it is another one of those stories that's not quite the genre movie that they expected to be, and so we're having some trouble there.
Okay. All right. Well, before we wrap up, what one piece of advice would you give to the listeners out there who are writing their own stuff right now, sci-fi, horror, or otherwise? What's important to take away from your experience?
Oh gosh, it's that you really got to love what you're doing. I know that sounds old hat and kind of obvious, but I've run into writers who are pursuing this for monetary gain or for fame, which is hilarious because like writers are really not famous people, or you know, almost because they feel like they can do better than the terrible movie that they just saw, and so they're setting this really low bar and saying I can do better than that crap. And it's got to come from a very like sort of emotional and positive place.
That's great. Yeah. I mean, it sounds like the thing that really championed this through the years was that passion. I mean, how many rejections do you think you went through between the pitches and everything else?
More than 30.
That's a lot.
Yeah.
That's a lot of driving to a place to be told no.
It is. But that's a lot of how the business goes. You got to realize that you may be in line for 50 no's before you get the right yes.
Mm-hmm. And that passion is what makes you stick with that.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's great. Well, Eric, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Arrival is out in theaters. You can go see it now. And if you are listening to this on iTunes, please leave us a rating or review. If you're not on iTunes, then you can subscribe on iTunes, and you can find this on finaldraft.com/podcasts. Thanks so much. This is Pete D'Alessandro, product manager here at Final Draft, signing off till next time.